We are back here in person, and we are recording. Time permitting, we do have some questions from our moderator. I'll introduce here in a second. And then once we get through those, we are going to put you all on a time limit, and I will be the timekeeper. Okay? I've got an iPad with big numbers on it. And thank you to Tom Clark Solutions. Is Tom here? I don't think he's here. Zoe? Are you Zoe?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, my God. Nice to meet you. Thank you so much, Zoe and Tom, for paying for this. I mean, they made this happen. As well as EDON, Economic Development Authority of Western Nevada. They are also a fiscal sponsor. Media sponsors, KWNK. Where are you, Tom? If you want to do your own radio show, contact Tom. I don't know if you need more radio shows, but... K-Wink Community Radio is on 97.7. And also Noticiero Movil is a media partner of ours. Thank you also to KUNR for being here and News Channel 2. Is that News Channel 2? 8. I'm so sorry. Oh, my God. You guys get really competitive about that. I am so sorry. Okay, big ground rules. Please focus your comments on yourself. We've done this before, some of you. This is not a debate. This is a forum for you all to get to know what they're thinking about where they want to take the city, not what their opponents are thinking. So we do ask that you reserve your comments about what you want to do and your vision. So did I miss anyone, Mary Claire? We're good. And without further ado, Connie Ray Goddard. Thank you for being our MC tonight.
Thank you.
She's got a lot of words to say.
Thanks, Bob. All right, I'm on my own. You're good with that one. All right. Thank you so much, Bob. I so appreciate you. And I do, before we begin tonight, want to say a very big thank you to Mary Claire Boucher, who's over here. Give a big round of applause to Mary, to Bob, and to This Is Reno for hosting the Washoe Candidates Forums. And as Bob mentioned, we'll be back here next Thursday and the following Thursday as well. So we'd love for you to join us. And as Bob mentioned, my name is Connie Ray, and I am the morning radio show host for Reno's newest radio station, 100.1 WeFM. I have worked in radio and television here in Northern Nevada for the past 24 years. My business partner and I founded A Story Media Productions, a video production company that has produced video projects for the city of Reno, the Downtown Reno Partnership, and nonprofits like Urban Roots and the Nevada Women's Fund. A Story Media Productions most recently produced Love Reno, which was a 30-minute video postcard dedicated to our community that aired on KTVN Channel 2, which featured the innovators, the creators, the artists, and the food culture that makes Northern Nevada such a desirable region. As Bob mentioned, I have emceed many events here in Northern Nevada, and recently I was asked if I was apprehensive about being the moderator for a political candidate forum. And I said, absolutely not, because it's not about politics for me. It is about the community. I believe in the importance of sharing all views and all opinions so that one can make their own conscious, informed decision, a decision that they believe is right for the direction in which they see their community moving towards. And tonight, we are going to learn from our mayoral candidates. We're going to hear from each of them. And you'll hear them share their vision for the future and how they see their accomplishments and what they would do to better the community as we move forward. Thank you again to the audience here tonight. We appreciate you being here. We again hope that you'll join us over the next 2 weeks. And if you are live streaming at home, we thank you again for being here virtually as well. As Bob mentioned, we are going to give you 3 minutes each to answer your questions. Bob has been gracious to hold up a timer. We will cut you off. We're those kind of people. We also, again, want you to focus on you and what you are bringing. This is not about you highlighting deficiencies in your opponents. And again, just keep an eye on the clock. Again, thank you for being here. And we're going to start with a really basic question, and that is we would like you to take the next 3 minutes to introduce yourself and explain why you feel you are the best person for the seat. And we'll just start down here with Joaquin. There you go.
Thank you. Forgive the notes. I'm a novice at this.
and I am a writer, so as a writer, I have to write what I say, as Hemingway once said. My name is Joaquin Roces, and I've spent the majority of my life, my adult life, serving my country and my state. I served this country in the U.S. Armed Forces as a Marine rifleman. I've served under Governor Kenny Gwynn as a commissioner on the Nevada Indian Commission, serving from 2000 to 2005, and as a special prosecutor for the Bureau of Indian Affairs, serving in the tribal courts in northern Nevada, from the colony here all the way out to Winnemucca. I also advocated for the victims of domestic violence and child abuse on the reservations and represented the tribal interests on the Washoe County Domestic Violence Task Force and the Fatality Review Team. As a student and employee of the University of Nevada, Reno, I developed and coordinated cultural and professional exchange programs. In 2009, I developed and implemented the Algerian Youth Leadership Program, which still continues at the university today. For my work as a victims advocate and a citizen diplomat, I was nominated for and awarded the Thornton Peace Prize for the University of Nevada. I'm currently a disaster relief operations volunteer for the Red Cross as well. I've responded to national disasters from Hurricane Harvey to the most recent fires that ravaged the Sierra Nevadas. I'm a sheltering supervisor and a logistics supervisor, so I'm boots on the ground. I get my feet dirty, my hands wet, and every once in a while I get my nose bloodied. I'm the dog in the fight. So that's a little bit about who I am. Currently my employment, I'm employed as a peer recovery support specialist for the National Alliance for Mental Illness. I developed a criminal justice program. It was a pilot program, and it's been going for 3 years right now. I work with individuals with a criminal justice history as well as with mental illness. The word peer does indicate that I live with mental illness. I have lived experience with it. I have post-traumatic stress disorder and borderline personality disorder as well. So that's my background, and that's it.
Oh, God. Sorry. So I'm William Mantle. This is my second time running for mayor. I was here in 2018, and though that doesn't speak to my success, it does speak to my commitment to this whole endeavor of improving our city, of serving our citizens, and trying to fight for a better Reno. I don't think there's a single argument that I could make that would reach all of you to convince me that I think that I'm the best person for the job. Because that's what I believe, that's why I'm here. I wouldn't be wasting your time otherwise. What I can say is that if your life has been perfect in the last 4 years since I ran, if you've had no struggle, if you've had no friends or family that have taken to any kind of deprivation or sorrow, then thank God for that. I am so happy for you. I really am. I truly, truly am. But I'm standing right outside of this wonderful library. There are people who are roughing it. People sleeping every day on those streets, and those numbers have doubled in the last year. The amount of nonprofit, mutual aid groups, citizens who are taking independent action to serve this city with services that they can't get otherwise has blown up. Dozens and dozens and dozens of groups are out there right now doing the work that, in my opinion, the city should be able to do. That you as a citizen shouldn't have to take your time, your energy, your funds and resources out there to the streets to ensure that your fellow man, your neighbor, your sister, your brother, it's just a friend, can be taken care of. I feel like there's a tremendous dearth in those provisions and those supplies. And I ran in 2018 saying the exact same thing. Hey, things are getting bad. Things are getting worse. We need to do something now, not 10 years from now, not 12 years from now, not have a 6-year plan. Now, and here we are 4 years later, and I don't think any of the things that I asked to fix have been fixed in the way that I would have fixed them at all. the affordability crisis has skyrocketed. Rent has increased on average 30%, as far as I understand it, in the last 2 years. I didn't get a 30% raise. Not that I expect that, but I can't understand why landlords are able to charge 30% more. What, supply and demand? Everyone always needed housing. That hasn't changed. We do have more people, but if you raise the rents, then who can afford that? Only people with more resources. At some point, we have to say there's greed there, and we have to confront it. We must confront it, and I want to. I have so many ideas. I poured hours and hours and hours onto my website to give you a really good idea of what I think we could do, some of the ideas I want to pursue to be mayor. I'd really appreciate your vote and your support. Thank you so much. I'm William Mantle.
Bob, is your preference we sit or stand? Does it make a difference to you? Okay, great. Hello, everyone. Thank you. It's so wonderful to be back in this lovely space. My name is Jenny Brekhus. I'm the Ward 1 Reno City Council member. I've served in that capacity since 2012. I'm running for mayor. The mayor is the first among equals on the council. And the pandemic has been difficult in every aspect of human life and organizations, and like even the city, particularly the city. Who better in these new times, and they are optimistic times, to lead us forward than a city planner who's a city specialist? And that's what I am. My father was on a small town planning board when I was growing up in my hometown. My sister sits on that now. That experience got me interested in city government. I became a city planner. I married a city planner. I have a 21-year-old who will not be a city planner. I've worked for three cities. I've focused my entire life on cities. And planners, if you're not familiar with the field, they synthesize all the issues in all the departments, infrastructure, public safety, to help move forward with public input and processes. That's what we do. That's what I'll bring to this seat. Now, Bob says, you know, don't talk about others, but I want to talk about tone, and the mayor's the first among equals. And we are all up here to make the case why an incumbent should not be rehired. And incumbents are rehired at 80% of the time. So we have a case to make. And the case is, one, and you got some literature from someone in my campaign today, is she was admonished by the Ethics Commission this year for using city resources for personal business. That is not good. The Reno Gazette Journal is a shell of what it used to be, even when she and I started. So if they were here, or the News and Review, you would have heard about it, but you're not. And that's no diss on Bob and the work that he's done to fill the gap. But it's our job to explain the tone that is going on at City Hall. I have a website. It's on my campaign literature. You'll read about that. A disclosure that she makes when her friend, who is a lobbyist, is bringing business before the city council. And I've seen audiences like you, their face go, wow, I thought I was on a level playing field. They are not. When she reads those disclosures that her friend is a lobbyist on development cases and other cases, they figure out pretty soon that City Hall is working for others and not for them. So we are in new times, exciting times. Fiscal sustainability of the organization is always the priority of a mayor and has to be, especially coming on in the Great Recession when the city laid off a third of its workforce. We have great opportunities ahead of us. The federal relief money is incredible, once-in-a-generation opportunity to invest in our community. I'm afraid it will be squandered because I've seen what the city's done in squandering money to developers to build luxury apartments without any conditions for working people and subsidized rents in those apartments. That is going to change, and we're going to go down to the legislature for rent control also at the same time next winter. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. My name is Tabitha Schneider, and I'll tell you a little bit about why I'm running for mayor and also a little bit about myself. So I grew up in the Midwest, so I come to Reno with a lot of Midwest values. I moved here in 2006 originally, and I've spent about 12 of the last 14 years here. I am currently the owner and one of the founders of Reno Hive Coworking and Incubation Space. And we have about 125 businesses incubating in our space. And that's exciting because we have everything from UNR students who are trying their first hand at their very first business, all the way up to two gentlemen who started incubating a few years ago. And they've grown to over 160 global employees, and their business is now valued at $1.5 billion. While I'm successful today, things weren't always that way. I have a daughter who is 30. I have a grandson who is 9. And they're the love of my life. But when I was pregnant with my daughter's father left when I was 7 months pregnant. So I ended up, as often many people do, on welfare. And I didn't want to stay in that system, so I knew that the only way out of that system was to go and get an education. So I bootstrapped it, finished my degree in a few years, and went on to get into real estate. So I've spent 35 years in real estate development. And then when the last downturn of the market came, I went back to school again and decided to go back and get an MBA. Now, how does all that wrap into being mayor? I stand for housing here in Reno. You've heard a few candidates talk about the housing crisis. We have a housing crisis here. The current rents of, you know, starting a one-bedroom apartment, $1,700 to $2,000, that is not sustainable. So I feel like the real estate experience that I have, and I've also traveled extensively, I've seen a lot of things work in other cities that we're not implementing here in Reno. I'll just give you one quick example. Auxiliary units, and oftentimes you hear them called mother-in-law units. We don't really have anything in code right now that could fast-track auxiliary units in someone's yard. And I feel that's really important because it works in other cities, and it gives people an opportunity to rent a smaller unit for, let's say, $800 to $1,000 a month. And then on the flip side, it also gives people an opportunity who maybe wouldn't have qualified for a mortgage to now have an additional revenue stream, and now they qualified to buy a house that they couldn't get without that additional revenue stream. That's just one of many ideas I have that I've seen work in other cities. So I stand for housing. Second thing, yes, oh, I'm done? Okay, thank you.
So excited. My name is Judi Rought, and I'm running for Reno's future. I was born and raised in Reno. I grew up in a economically challenged neighborhood. And I did leave for a little while, like many 18-year-olds. I wanted to go get away from my mother, which is weird to say, the 2 days before or 3 days before Mother's Day. But, you know, when you're 18. So I went to Kansas, and I got my education, and I started my career. I came home to Reno 2 years ago. By day, I am a financial controller for a women-led startup company that specializes in private equity. I have been in accounting services, an accounting professional, for 14 years now. I've worked in everything from small businesses to worldwide corporations to nonprofit organizations. My career focus has been on streamlining, creating efficiencies, and sustainability, which these are all things we want in government, right? I mean, we want to make sure that we have some sustainability so that we can keep going as a city. Sorry, I'm finally hitting some of that nerve thing going on. So I have an MBA. I'm also a certified management accountant, which to you means I like budgets a lot. And that's another thing you can imagine being in a government position that you want to see. I'm also a coach for Girls on the Run. So when I say that I'm running for Reno's future, I'm literally a runner. I normally run half marathons, but with the time constraints recently, I've been sticking to 5Ks. I have a couple of runner friends here with me who are like, why aren't you doing half marathons with me? I'm like, I got a couple things going on. But what that means to you, other than, you know, that I'm out running all the time, is that I am self-driven, and I am always pushing myself to do better. I'm always trying to beat my own personal best, and that's going to be helpful to the city in that manner. So I don't have any government experience, I'll be honest with you on that. But, you know, an infamous former politician once said that government is supposed to be run like a business. Well, I don't quite believe that. I believe that government is supposed to be run as professionally and as efficiently as a business, as a for-profit business. And I think that's really going to help in the long run. So I know there's a lot of other subjects that we're going to talk about, so rather than getting into all the various details, I'm going to pass this on to the next person and save us a little bit of time. Thanks, Judi. You're welcome.
Hello, everybody. My name's Jesse Razo, and I'm running for mayor. The reason why I'm running for mayor is I come in the name of my Lord, one nation under God, and my allegiance to the United States of America. I bring repentance to the city in the spirit of truth and in righteousness. Blessed are all the families that are found in the biggest little city in the world. And I come with the record of building almost 25 years in constructing and building in the city. I've been with the unions, both the carpenters and the local unions. And as a result, being out in the field, we have a good eye as to how our taxpayer money is being spent. As we're in the trenches now, building the police station, we see what's going on, and I think when the time comes to be able to address issues as to how the taxpayers' money is being spent, I think in righteousness and in truth, we can speak. I came to the biggest little city in 97 with a wife and three children. I come through the Valley of Visions and Dreams. I came as a dreamer. And at the same time, there was a spiritual avenue open, and it brought us here to the city. My children were raised, and now we're beginning to see and we're beginning to tie everything in, and this is why I'm running for mayor, is to be able to understand the past, the present, the future, and to be able to say that what's in front of us is greater, but we still have our own issues, and we have our issues, you know, in terms of our homeless, and in terms of, you know, the housing. And coming from the Bay Area from the 80s, and understanding the boom that happened there, you know, and seeing it again, you know, it comes with understanding and having that experience or seeing it. And when we see it coming a second time, then I think it's time that maybe, you know, if we see it, then I believe the standing up and to be able to help and address the city. I believe in the working class. I believe in the American dream. Okay, we're done? All right, and there's a list that goes on. Thank you, guy.
Thank you. It's a question that has been brought up by many of you here this evening. And as our area does continue to face a housing crisis, how do you plan to find solutions for housing affordability across all income levels? We'll start with you.
I think there should be a cap on the housing, and everything's been because of the developers were like in their chain, and as a result, it keeps prices up, and we're struggling with it. Rather, I think there should be some more of a little bit of control, and it's a pro and con where both sides can come and try to deal with it and maintain it for the people.
Thank you. Judi?
So when I came back to Reno in 2020, I came from Kansas. Rent's just a little bit lower there. So I had a little sticker shock getting a one-bedroom apartment in a neighborhood that is beginning gentrification for $1,339 a month. 6 months later, my now husband and I are buying a house. They raised the rent to $1,555 a month. For anyone who can do the math, that's a 16% increase. So I have been absolutely appalled by that huge jump. I was already in sticker shock from coming from Kansas, and then that just made it worse. So the ideas that I've seen that I like is that we do a cap on how much a landlord can increase rent when someone's renewing their lease. If I was renewing my lease and I couldn't afford $200 a month more, what do? You probably don't have a deposit saved up to move somewhere else, and if you do, it's gonna be even more expensive at that point. So where do you go? So I want to see a cap on lease renewals that they can't go more than 5% per year. I want to see the city create a deposit assistance program. Rather than seeing someone go out on the street, I want the city to help them be able to get into the next place that might be more affordable for them. The other piece is we do have a lot of growth going on. We need more units. And it makes sense from a business standpoint that everybody, all the developers, are wanting to build the high-end or more expensive units. I want to see at least 10% of every new multifamily housing complex have 10% of those units are going to be income-based units. That way we're creating affordable housing with every single project. Because, yeah, it's great that we're building these beautiful luxury apartments, but with rent prices going up, what happens is the people who were affording those are now looking at the middle range. The middle range is looking at the lower range because that's what they can afford. So what happens when the people who are in the lower range, they have nowhere to go? We need to create somewhere for them to go with every single project that's being built.
Tabitha?
Hello again. So again, since I spent 35 years in real estate development, I feel like I can collaborate and work well with the developers that are in town. We have a lot of developers that want to build, and they have challenging times working with the current city council to get things done. So I feel like I can bring that leadership and the collaboration that we need to work between the community, within our master plan, with the developers to get things done. I agree with Judi. I think that we need to, when we're working with the developers, that we need to have a certain amount of units set aside for low-income housing. I've seen that work really well in cities like Portland and Sacramento. Sacramento did something very interesting where they built some artist lofts, and they took a certain percentage, and the artists can present their portfolios, and then they can live there for a couple $100 a month instead of a couple thousand. And the rest of the higher priced units that are slightly above market rent supplement the artists to live there. My grandmother, when this was back in Ohio many years ago, but you know, she was living on Social Security, $700-$800 a month. And I know when I go out and I talk to the homeless folks on the street, the unhoused, a lot of them do have incomes. They have $700 or $800 a month, and they were living in a lot of the hotel units that have been torn down here in Reno. We've torn down over 800 motel units in the city, and we have no other displacement plan for the people that were living in those units, which is a disgrace. And so we really have to work with the developers, the community, and, you know, amongst the city council, and get rid of that, the dissent going on in the city council to get things done. So that, auxiliary units, I have about 25 other ideas. So I would invite you to follow me on Facebook if you can, Tabitha for Mayor, or you can go to my website, tabithaformayor.com, and look and see all the issues I plan to tackle when I get elected. Thank you.
So around 2015, 2016, I said, and it was true, Reno had an affordability edge compared to other cities. But I said, you know, I think a city can lose that quickly. And little did I know how quickly we would lose that. It was the Great Recession reset. It was the growth. You can call it the Tesla effect. But we did lose it. And it is devastating to our community. So the market is going to produce 90% of the housing stock, the private market. Only 10% will really ever be subsidized. But we're in a great moment. The federal relief program is bringing a lot of money to increase that number of subsidized units. They did it a decade ago during the Great Recession, and I actually went down and worked on a lot of those projects for the Nevada Housing Division. They're formulaic, but they do produce, and they are a great element of our housing stock. But how do you get the private market to do it there? And that has been the lack of focus at the city council. My colleague Naomi Dewar, who is here, was the only other person to join me on the Reno City Council in 2017 to advance an accessory dwelling unit ordinance. She's been calling them auxiliary, but it's really accessory dwelling unit ordinance, second units. It went down. The incumbent mayor put it down. I and Naomi Dewar tried to get it across with a recommendation of the Planning Commission. We would have 400 smaller units on single-family lots by now, to my estimate, if we had been able to get there. So that's that. The sentiment right now is just let everything be built everywhere and we'll get there. We won't. We're seeing, and I have a podcast off the dais. I recently talked to someone who really knows the development market. We are seeing lots prep up in Somerset, $150,000, $200,000. That's not addressing affordability. Affordability is urban. It's recycling land. There's a lot of tools in the toolbox we have not deployed because of focus. But in the last year, things have very much accelerated, problematic. Cities, big cities, Clark County, North Las Vegas, me as mayor, are going to go to the legislature and say we need a form of anti-rent gouging authority. Cities and counties don't have that authority, but we're going down to Carson, and if you think you're going to be in Carson as a representative come February, guess what? We're coming down there as the big city representatives, and we want this authority. It's not going to hit every landlord and apartment owner in town, because a lot of them are responsible, but it's going to hit the gougers because we cannot continue this pattern. 52% of Reno residents are renters, and they need protections, and they will be getting it next year. It will be my biggest focus for the legislative session. Thank you.
So in 2017, I lived in a small house in Ward 3 with six other people, because that's what I could afford back then. I was a sexual assault victims advocate for the crisis call center. I was making about $12, got a raise to $12.50. So that was pretty cool. When I was in my master's program, because millennials have had it hard, we got the Great Recession right after college. I was like, oh man, there are no jobs here, so I guess I'll go back into school. Got out of my master's program for criminal justice in 2011. There's still no jobs. What am I doing here? Couldn't even be a buffet server with a master's degree, which I guess overqualified, but I needed to eat. So I went to do more school and went into a PhD program in Omaha for criminology. Then I came back to Reno, and I saw how quickly things were deteriorating, which is why I ran in 2018, because housing affordability was going crazy then. I spoke with security guards at City Hall saying, I'm moving back to Tennessee because my rent just raised $400. So this is not a new problem. And I always like to say that the best predictor of future behavior is past behavior. We know that this has been a problem and we haven't done the right things for it. And frankly, I think that means that we need a change. And I would like to be that change. I completely agree with everyone else that we do need rent caps. I actually went to the state legislature already and spoke to an individual down there about our modified home rule. And he said, well, we're not sure if the county can do that yet. So the only way to ask for an opinion on law from the attorney general is to go to a representative. So I went to one of our county commissioners who has gone to the district attorney, and I'm waiting on an answer to see if we can actually just ask the county to do it. Because as in my understanding and my interpretation of the law, we can do it right now. We could have done it since 2015, and we haven't. Whether there's not the gumption, the courage, or the aggression, I don't know, but I wanted it back then. People needed it now. They need it now. For other ideas for affordability and housing, correct, we need infill development. We need things that will give us a long, sustained capacity to house people that isn't luxury. People don't need giant, 400 square feet bedrooms for themselves. I recently got a home in 2020, right before everything went crazy, and it's thanks to my mom, I'll be honest, because I couldn't afford it myself. So thanks, Mom. But so many of the houses I looked at, I was like, this is tremendous. Who wants to live in this cavernous bedroom? Let's build homes for people of the missing middle. Let's get our zoning laws in order. Thank you.
Robert Kennedy once said that it takes more than courage under fire or the bravery to make sacrifices to lead a nation, but also the bravery to discard the comfort of illusion, to do away with false hopes and alluring promises. I believe this is a great nation and a great people, and we derive our greatness from our diversity. And I'm happy to see the diversity of the candidates running for mayor right now, and it reflects our city. I believe we live in a great country, but any who seek to confront rather than speak plainly, anyone who seeks to comfort rather than speak plainly, to reassure rather than to instruct, to promise satisfaction rather than to reveal frustration, those people deny that greatness and drain that strength. We are in a housing crisis. And I saw the same thing happen to the housing bubble prior to the Great Depression or the Great Recession. The same thing happened. In a week's time, prices on homes outpaced the salary of the local working class people. They could not afford homes in a week's time. And now it's happening in the rental sector of the market. And it's going to lead to another bubble and another collapse. We need to have housing that's sustainable and affordable. And on top of that, affordable housing impacts more families and people of color. When I lost my housing in September of 2021 because my rent went from $900 to $1,400 for a two-bedroom, I ended up staying at the CARES campus for a month and a half until I could find housing that I could afford. And I was working full-time. And it was still on the high end of the range that I had worked in my budget. I was at the CARES campus. I believe it is time to, like my colleagues, that Reno looks at rent caps and as well as cap and managing growth. We have to have the role of the city government needs to take on more of a stewardship than base our decisions on just greed and grab the wealth.
Our next question. We have seen unprecedented growth in our area in the last 5 years. It's put a strain on our overall infrastructure, emergency services, and our environment. What is your plan for sustainable growth as we move forward? Judi, we'll start with you.
I was hoping someone else got to go first this time. So there's a couple of areas that we're all feeling the pain. So infrastructure is a huge pain point right now for us. Has anybody else had fun with traffic lately? Yeah, traffic. So I've lived in another city, and it was a bigger city than this, and they were able to get ahead of the growth. That's the big thing that Reno needs to do, is we've got to stop being reactive, and we need to be proactive. I've seen it work. I know Reno can get there. So there's a couple different pieces with roads, obviously. We need to get ahead of that. We're going to have to work with the state and the federal government to do some of that. God knows this spaghetti bowl needs flyovers. It needs to be done right. It's just too much of a bottleneck for everybody. I want to see that our emergency services, I'm really glad that you mentioned emergency services in specific, because that to me is a huge piece. We need to hire more people in our emergency services departments. I'm an accountant. What do? I work with numbers. If our overtime budget is that high, we can afford to hire more employees. You know what happens when we have more employees in the emergency services? They're not overworked. You know what happens when they're not overworked? They give better service to our community as a whole. They're not stressed out. They're not, I don't want to say trigger happy, but they're not trigger happy. They're able to provide better service, and they're able to provide better care to our entire community. Another thing with the infrastructure and the growth is we need to make internet a standardized utility. Guess what? There's a ton of remote workers here. We're taxing what internet services that we have. I step outside my office and I have to drive halfway down the block before my Pandora connects so I can listen to music. And that's just cell service. When I bought my house, we both had a certain carrier. My husband and I did. We were like, okay, cool, we'll stay with that same carrier. They're like, oh no, you only get 15 megs per second. And I'm like, okay, well, my work only reimburses me if I have 75 or more, so sorry, I got to go somewhere else. Could you imagine if we had something like citywide Wi-Fi? We would have to work with the city of Sparks and Washoe County, of course, to make sure it's consistent across the board. But it's plausible. I've looked at the numbers on it. It is plausible. I would rather pay to the city and have something that's a standardized good quality than to pay another vendor and have iffy hit or miss. Oh, wait, it's down again because there's too many people taxed. Too many people taxing the system. So those are some of the big pieces that I want to see as we're working forward. And they are huge projects, but we can do it. We can get there. Reno can get ahead of the game. We can be proactive and not reactive.
I'm going to invite Judi to our co-working space because we have a gig up and down symmetrical Wi-Fi. So talking about growth and sustainability, one of the things that need to happen in the city is, first of all, we need some transparency. We have a real lack of transparency going on. We also, the city used to have a grant writer a long time ago, and I know I've heard a few people mention a few times, there's a lot of federal monies out there right now and a lot of state monies we're not taking advantage of because we don't have a great grant writer on staff. I just read that in the state of Nevada, there's $500 million coming down the pipeline for affordable housing. So we need to be able to grab our share of that money. So to have a sustainable city, you need to be able to have affordable housing, which I have a plan to manage. You need to have transparency, and you need to be a city council, a mayor that's working for all the people, not a few zip codes, not a few developers, not a few casinos. I want to be the mayor for every single person in this room, every single person on the street. I want to be your voice, and I want to work together and collaborate to make sure that moving forward, you know, we're looking into the future and seeing what we need to do today to have smart growth in the city. I'm glad Judi also brought up about safety because we need to look forward, you know, with the traffic and everything. We need to look forward and work with the engineers and NDOT and make sure that our roads can manage the capacity so we're not sitting in line for hours when we're in the spaghetti bowl. So, you know, I plan on bringing that and tackling a lot of other issues once I become mayor. Thank you.
Thank you. So this is really an area of my expertise as a city planner. I've taught classes on it. I've worked on these issues. And when I came on in 2012, I knew this city's master plan. It's your big high-level policy document. I said it is a 1997 document. We need to update it, and we did. We adopted it in 2017. And then went out of shelf, and implementation has lagged. Because master plans really have a whole bunch of to-do lists. And the reason implementation has lapsed is because we have a developer-driven focus in this community, not a public and a policy focus. And that's by design. I have a podcast. It's called Off the Dais. I dropped an episode yesterday called about warehouses, how we accidentally all of a sudden became a warehouse community. And that was never the policy. That was letting the market do what the market wanted to do at other costs. Some of those warehouse developers, by the way, were represented by that friend that the mayor makes her disclosures about when those projects come before. We can't build like that. So the two things we need to do to get back on the master plan is monitor the land use, where we're short, where we've got too much demand, where we're missing. You're from the North Valleys, we don't have services, we don't have commercial, because we gave it up for warehousing. That's very key. We also need to do area plans. We need to divide the city into areas and do area plans. You cannot get where you need to go at the high level. You need to go in at the neighborhood and area level. That's why Verdi has all that development and a terribly deficient, unprogrammed overpass that needs to get built. You need to go out, understand your growth projections in an area level, and synthesize those with all the providers. We've got NDOT, we've got RTC, we've got TUMWA. It's complex. You need to get there, and you need to agree upon a balance of rebuilding your older neighborhoods while you take on new neighborhoods, new road miles, new areas patrol. It's a fine balance, but there are ways to get there. I know how to do it. I've lived and thought this for 25 years. As mayor, it will be where we'll get, because there are a lot of models out there, and I know how to customize it for Reno, Nevada at this current point in time. Thank you.
What do we call uncontrolled growth in the body? Cancer. Yeah, there's a smart person. Yeah, cancer. Unfortunately, the city's been a little cancerous, if you ask me, these past number of years. That's not good. I'd love to be the radiation therapy. Good. What I'm saying is that we have had a plan, our master plan. We haven't been following it. We haven't been following it to the degree that the city council has set itself a goal to follow its own master plan. That's not a goal you need to set. That's your master plan, but it's there. I was on the Ward 3 Neighborhood Advisory Board in 2017, and I heard about Daybreak. If you've all familiar with Talus Valley now, because they wanted to rebrand to get away from Daybreak. That's 4,000 homes right off of South Meadows and Veterans Parkway now. And that's right in our floodplain. It's a farmland of statewide importance. So if we're ever going to have food sustainability, it'd be on farmland. You got it. But it's not going to be there for long because it's about to be cemented. That seems crazy to me. That seems really crazy, especially with the idea that you wanted to put mostly single-family homes there instead of the opportunity to make a missing middle mecca. I mean, you could have just made it wonderful. You could have made the walkable, lovely city that, or town, I guess it would be really down there, that everybody wants, with resources and venues and a neighborhood center, because I live in South Reno. I love the wetlands. They're amazing, all those orange-winged blackbirds. But there's nothing down there. It's a place to reside, not a place to live. And so much of our city just looks like that. Houses, as far as the eye can see, people are there. There's nothing there for them, though. There's now Osion Park, which is way cool, really. It's a nice park. But that's it. And that's been a long time coming, since 2015 or 16. What I want to see is a change to our development, a change to our emphasis, that our infrastructure is there before the homes are there, that we adopt the Nevada State Rail Plan. That thing is amazing if you haven't looked at it. It's also like 300 pages, so I don't blame you. But it's gotten a complete plan to get rail for everyone. And I'm sad to hear that no one's once talked about the environment. We're never going to have more wildlands in Reno. Everything that's cemented will stay cemented. I don't see us tearing down our highways anytime soon. I don't see us saying less roads is more. But they could be, because we can't road our way out of this problem entirely. We have to adopt more public infrastructure that gets people who can where they need to be. Thank you.
To touch on the safety issue, I want to mention the really expensive district, the red program on the Park Lane lot was originally slated to have a fire station with the project. The first thing that was cut from that project was that fire station. That project is going to add about 1,000 homes in the densest part of the city, straddling two of the busiest fire stations, not in Reno, not in the state, but in the nation compared to other fire stations. Our community has grown in the last 20 years by over 60,000, and the fire department in the city has only grown by 4 firefighters. The last time this city passed a bond to fund the fire department was in 1996. Public safety will be a priority in my administration, whether it's public safety, ensuring that our first responders have the equipment, the staff, and the personnel to keep our property and our lives safe, and to ensure that every resident has access to health care. When I say health care, I include mental health in that. We like to dissect one from the other, but your head is in the same chemical sac that contains your bones, your fluids, and all your spasmodic nerves in it. So mental health is part of health care. And despite all the equity laws that have been passed, insurance companies are still not being held accountable for that. As far as growth, within our means, from pushing out more aggressively towards renewable energy to managing our growth in a more sustainable and responsible way, City leadership needs to take on more of a stewardship role for the community rather than the status quo that is leading us nowhere. Caps on rent and growth need to be considered and implemented. We live in the high desert and water resources are already stretched beyond our means. You cannot only build your way to prosperity without responsibility or accountability. We have other natural resources in abundance as well. We have over 380 days of sunlight. We have the space to develop that. And thank you.
Jesse? Yeah.
In the last 20 years, I remember when we were working in the bridges that were being built, the first expansion bridge, the Mustang Bridge, the Spaghetti Bowl, and the Panther Bridge. Four of those I worked on, and seeing the growth, what happens is that when we're building and then we don't have the manpower, and it gets overwhelming. And for the safety of the workers, the safety for the fire station, the safety for the fire department goes hand in hand, and it's the same experience. Understanding the infrastructure of it, the expanding of the bridges and the highways, and also renovating a lot of the major casinos, and being shorthanded, and for safety reasons and for safety purposes and for the public, we have a pretty good experience of seeing that. And so as mayor, I think it's just a matter of just trying to tighten it up a little bit, bringing everybody to the table, and making sure that, that everything is distributed right and justly for everybody, for our safety, for the community, and for our city. Thank you.
Moving on to our next question. The city is allowed to propose two legislative bills per session. If you were the mayor, what two specific city-related bills would you like to see passed in the legislature, and why? And we'll start with you.
Ooh, exciting.
Thank you. Thank you, Lily.
So if I'm wrong, and that we don't actually have the authority in our region to do rent cap increases or anti-gouging laws, as I hope we do at the county level again, we need that. That's period. We need that. Absolutely 100%. The other thing we need is we need the ability to actually diversify our tax base, which is not fun to talk about. It's not, I know. But if we're going to grow, and we're going to grow by, what, another like 40,000 individuals by the turn of this decade, minimum, is the expectation. How are we going to get enough money for them? How do we get enough police officers? Firefighters, for sure. I spoke with them, and they are desperate for having four individuals per engine, because that's what they require, and that's what they need to be safe. How do we get enough money for them? Where's that come from? So either we get more taxes or we have less services for more people. That's the reality. And that sucks, because taxes aren't fun. But if they're spent responsibly, if they're done with clarity, accountability, and transparency, then they can provide the services that you need so that you can have a safety and a comfort in the city that you deserve. Because it's my opinion that government is here to provide the highest quality of life for its citizens. Stop. That's it. That's all I think we should be doing. And whatever we can do to that end and must do to that end, I'm for.
Thank you, William. Jenny?
So, we have a part-time legislature that shows up down in Carson City every other year for, 120 days or so. They have a lot of authority over cities, more than you see in other states. So cities are in business every single month. The charter says twice a month the Reno City Council meet. We got a lot of folks. We're the closest to them. We got a lot going on. And there's a real imbalance in Nevada where those part-time legislators show up every other year and have a lot of authority and sometimes aren't responsive. And so that needs to flip. It doesn't matter how many bills you have. Sometimes you can do really well with zero bills. You need to impress upon them, particularly the northern representatives, what are northern issues that need to be solved. One is going to be this rent gouging. Number two, to be honest with you, is we need to reform broken RTC. If RTC, which is a creation of federal transportation law, formed today as a metropolitan authority, it would have a much different composition on the governance body. Right now it has five. Five people overseeing the region's transportation dollars, which are immense, without parallel in terms of local taxes. And two of them are county commissioners. They're not focused on urban issues. They weren't focused on the transit system. They're not focused on rebuilding. They're focused a lot of times on building new outlying roads. We need a new reform of how we do transportation in this region, but we also need to flip the script in Carson City that city's business is important business, and we need to meet those needs. It's really, really critical. We're acting like a young state. We can't be a young state any longer. People are in Carson, state officers. They've got hardships, though. There's tough challenges with Nevada. And we're outgrowing a lot of fundamentals. But that's for people in Carson to figure out. But they need to be responsive to city and local needs. And they do not very often. Thank you.
Tabitha?
I'm glad I got to go, fourth here, so I had a minute to think about this, because I have a lot of ideas that should be introduced to the legislature. So one idea that I have would be to have broadband for all. I have another day job, so I travel to California a few days a week, and I work with a company that's a public company, and we are working on a large broadband project right now. So broadband basically manages the capacity. A long time ago when cell phone service started, you saw big towers go up and that would do coverage. You would get the coverage map if you went to T-Mobile or Verizon to see if you actually had coverage in your area. And now the name of the game in probably the next 10 years in wireless is broadband. And that manages the capacity because now we all have cell phones that have become our TVs, our computers, and we need capacity. And so I think a city that is wired well has sustainability. If a business is thinking about coming into an area, if you don't have broadband, you can't work. So we need more fiber laid down in the city. So I think I would propose something to the legislature related to broadband, first of all. I'm torn on a couple things here on the back end, but I think Jenny's kind of hinting that we have a weak mayor system. And so you can't pass anything significant in Reno because it has to go back to the state legislature. So I think I would propose that we bring the power back to the city and put that back in the people and spend our tax dollars back in Reno and have the ability to do that efficiently and have a strong mayor system instead of a weak mayor system. So those are the two things I'd pick. Thank you.
I think William's been reading my blog and the articles about me. Oh my goodness. Love you too. Gosh, here I was thinking he was thinking pink or something. So the first thing I like to point out is I just bought a house for $575,000 last year. My friends in Kansas were like, wow, did you buy a mansion? No, it's a fixer-upper. So the property value on my house is $190,000. Right now, Zillow says it's $660,000. So the assessed value is a third of the real value. I know right now we can only increase property values by 3% a year, and it's not really being done that much. If we can start increasing little by little Kaizen baby steps, if we can start increasing what the actual assessed value is closer to real life, we're going to have more tax base available to us. So that's one of the things that needs to be done at state level. We need to get the state to agree to that. And I know, here I am saying, oh my God, we need to raise taxes and no one's gonna like that. I get that. But we need to have more money somewhere to make our city better. And this is gonna help the city, the county, and the state. It's gonna help us across the board if we can get that, start moving. Even if we get it up to 50%. I'm like, that's at least that much more. And it's just little bitty bits that you probably won't even notice it, quite honestly, by the time you take it out of your mortgage and divide it by 12 months and all of that. We're talking 20, 30 bucks a month for most people is what the increase is going to be each year. So it's really not that bad for most people. The other side of it is I want to see rent caps, too. Taking my ideas, see how you are. So like I said earlier, I want to see maybe let's cap it at 5% because for most people that's reasonable. If your rent, dear God, is $1,500 a month, which is a lot for most people, that's only a $75 a month increase when you renew your lease. That's at least more tolerable than 200 and 300 or what did you say yours went up by? $500 a month in 1 year? That's just too much for most people who are going to be able who need the help. Let's face it, we need to focus on the people who are on the lower to average income level, and that's who is going to help. And the more that we can come up with the tax base, the more we can support those who are on that lower to middle income levels. So those are the two big pieces for me. Thank you.
If I were to tell you no new taxes, would you believe me? Right? Okay, so I mean, you know, when we see that, we need to understand that, you know, if it has to be done, then you know, then we have to man up to it. And we balance it together as a community, as a city. But if you have other outsiders coming in and putting packages together, to be able to submit it to the legislator and to say, hey, well, we're going to jack your taxes up. This right is going to be taken, and so everybody's going to be taxed. And this is what we're seeing. No different than with the developers expanded, built it, now we're obligated. And so as a result, you know, I would fight to keep it in the balance. And to be able to have, you know what I mean, the spending for everybody and, you know, we put caps on, you know, and how things are jacked up, for instance, what happened to him. You know, and then it's the same thing for our taxes, for home taxes, in terms of, you know what I mean, how we're governed and how the procedures and policies go in America. Thank you.
Joaquin?
No new taxes. We're just going to raise the old ones. No, I'm just kidding. So, two bills. The first one is that all new construction from 2023 on be tied to renewable or alternative energy. We have the space. We have the resources to do that. Like I was saying earlier, we get 380 days of sunlight. Even in the depth of winter, we get sunlight. And we have a secondary. We have wind as well. And the space to develop this. If we moved every city-owned building and facility off the grid onto alternative energy, the city would not only save money, but it would also have a revenue generator because it could sell that surplus to neighboring states like California. We're putting all these mega warehouses and homes onto the same stressed-out grid. Since 2017, 30 wildfires have been contributed to the aging and collapsing infrastructure of PG&E, and it has destroyed thousands of homes and killed 100 people. We're marching down that same dangerous path. So the big thing I want to see is a more of a shift to alternative energy to make ourselves more sustainable as a community, and so that we can generate that revenue and make up that revenue that we've lost during the pandemic. Oh my God, I have extra time. And of course, rent caps. I think it's been hammered, that horse has been kicked to death, but rent caps are another thing. Whether you called it price gouging, but it's rent caps, cap the rent. People are getting away with it. And also, we need to regulate companies like Siegel Suites that are coming in, buying old structures, and then pushing it as substandard housing without being responsible for making that sure those buildings are safe for tenancy to begin with. Do I have, yeah, good.
Thank you. Our next question, we are going to give you the next 3 minutes to provide some closing comments focused on yourself and your campaign. And we will start with you, Jenny.
Thank you so much. And it's been a pleasure to be here tonight. You know, in conclusion, we're all here trying to make a case to be the hired person against someone who already has the job. And that's a big step for someone to challenge an incumbent. I think there's a way to do it respectfully, but it is our job to point out the deficiencies of the incumbent. And we started the same day, and you know, sometimes people will say to me, Jenny, you seem mad, you got kind of sometimes biting. Someone said it even walking in here today. I want to assure you, I don't have all the answers. I don't know it's this way or my way or the highway. It's not. That's why I'm out there so much doing constituent services and learning from folks. I was on the campaign trail 2 years ago, and part of getting on this campaign trail is to work with others who are interested in politics, younger, and show them and work with them and have them come along on my campaign to bring on the next leaders. I'm very excited about that. But the challenges are very big. I've been around a lot of mayors, and I'm thinking, you know, what do you see, what do you want in a mayor? And you really need someone who has confidence, who's a public servant, and can split aside. It's not for personal aggrandization. It is really about serving, and it's results. You can say all the nice things, but if you are making a disclosure that your friend is representing Mr. Jacobs, who's, and the decisions you're making are facilitating the displacement of over 500 of our poorest residents downtown, that's not nice. Those are mean policies. And I, when I speak harshly about those, it's because I come from a point of anger about this disservice that's being done to some of our most vulnerable Reno people. But I can do it from a place, from a lot of personal confidence. I'll be home tonight, making my first cut of my rhubarb, rolling out a pie, watching, I think, a baseball series with my husband. Lights out at 10:30 after reading about 10 minutes about Western pioneers. That's how my life is. I'm going down to spend Mother's Day with my parents. My best friend from when I was 6 was up here last weekend with her daughter for volleyball. I have lots of friends. Try and be a good neighbor. I've been with the same husband for 25 years. I have the relationship I always wanted with my adult daughter. I am a very comfortable person in my skin, and I will speak as someone who wants to lead this community with no personal agenda. Thank you.
William?
So what was the question? Thank you so much for your time tonight. It's truly a pleasure to see your civic activism getting out there and trying to educate yourself about who your would-be representatives would be, or, well, those who would show up. A city is only as successful as its lowest member in society. If someone is suffering, if someone is hurting, if someone is hungry, if someone is cold, if someone dies on the streets tonight, we've all failed. City's not a success, period. Period, stop. And that's what we need to address first and foremost. That's the most important thing. And I have not had nearly enough time to talk about all the people who are in need right now. That's why I'm running. That's what I care about to address immediately and first, because I'll be frank, I'm lucky. I know that I'm privileged and fortunate and blessed with the situation that I've got. I can take care of what I need and give some back to the community. That's how I'm able to run. There are so many people here who are in our community who are brilliant, smart, talented, capable, and they find themselves hungry every night, cold every night. We need to help them. That's who I'm running for, because if we can help them, then everybody else is going to be helped, period. We can all lift up each other, and we need to do that. There has not been nearly enough focus on those individuals who are desperate and needy, and deservedly so. We can do better, and I want to do better for Reno. And what we need to understand is that our passions are for them, for our citizens. We all want to help each other. I know we can all agree on that. How we get there, I know that can be sorted. I know that can be a hot topic, and I know that can be difficult. I don't care who the incumbent is. I don't care who the next mayor is. I want it to be me, but frankly, we can all do better. We all must be those better representatives in our society, in our communities, stand up and advocate. I want to run because I feel like the representatives I've worked with and tried to work with turn aside from me. They don't talk to me. They don't answer my emails or my phone calls, or I get this shitty boilerplate email saying, well, look what I've done in the past. Great. What about today? What about the concern I'm coming to you with? These are the people who I feel ignore us time and time again. These are the people who I don't want to be in our office. I won't be that kind of a representative if you put me there. I promise. I have a whole list of leadership promises on there. One of them being, I'd like to work more than twice a month. I think that's fair. I think we meet at 10 a.m., and that's ridiculous. The city council needs to do more, can do more, and I would lead them to do more.
Thank you. Joaquin?
What do I love about Reno the most? I love that I can be skateboarding at the city plaza and in 15 minutes be dipping my toes in the truck at Mayberry Park. And then be 10 minutes back again enjoying a diverse palette of dining options in Midtown. I love the fact that I can watch a Broadway musical at the Pioneer Theater and in an hour be shredding powder up in Mount Rose. I love the diversity and the dynamic diversity of our community, and that's what's kept me here. I left for the Marine Corps after high school, and what brought me back is that sense of community. But I'm seeing that being eroded away. I'm seeing green spaces in downtown being replaced with concrete and hostile architecture. I want to protect that. I want to draw a line to keep the green spaces we have, to protect against the greed that's out there that's pushing this runaway development and just plowing over every tree and blade of grass that's out there. This is my community. This is where I live. This is where I grew up in, where I raised my kids. When I talk about homelessness, it's not just a talking point or a bullet point on a PowerPoint. It's lived experience. I have been homeless. I've stayed at the CARES campus. I think it's abominable that that building houses 600 people and there's no running water and no restrooms inside of it. I donated my own funds to get them a pallet of bottled water because they did not have enough drinking water there. I was fortunate enough to stay there and still have a job. But there are people there. There are most vulnerable people, as my colleagues have pointed out, and they're the ones that need the stewardship that they are owed to by those. Carnegie once said, with great wealth comes great responsibility. Those of us that have need to pick up the slack for those of them that have not. And the homeless is not created by some natural disaster or war. The homeless is created by social policies we engineer. And that's the only way we're going to solve it is through that.
Thank you. Jesse?
Okay, in conclusion, I think that all of us have embraced and brought good issues to everybody. And, you know, definitely as we come to and we ask for your vote for, you know, for the best one to win. But I want to close with this. As mayor of the city, wait a minute, let me regroup. Building the infrastructure or building the police station right now, the timetable, when the police station is good done, we're going to have, they're going to be named civil servants, okay? And so as mayor, I will tie in the civil servants and they bring the city of servants. And this will lead the city into a messianic territory that eventually, as the time comes, the plan will be will begin to unfold. At the same time, you know, we're having all these issues, and definitely I think in America and as Americans, we can begin to turn and deal with it immediately while we're not making it an issue, you know what I mean, and dragging it. Because what's in front of us for the city is greater. And with that, I close, and as running for mayor, I ask for your vote. And thank you.
Thank you. Judi?
How many people have been voluntold before? I see lots of hands, lots of voluntolds. That doesn't happen to me because I have what they call helium hand. I just tend to volunteer for things all the time, which means that I'm here to serve. I'm here to help our community. I had someone ask me recently, because I am a Democrat, what do I do if I have to get along with a Republican? I said, you know what? My best friend and her husband are both Republican. We get along just fine. We look at what we need to get done. Are we taking care of the kids today? Are we finger painting? Are we fixing the fence? Are we making Reno a better city again? What are we doing? It doesn't matter to me on the politics. I don't want to be known for who I'm fighting with, but who I'm fighting for. And I'm fighting to make Reno a better city. I'm running for Reno's future. So, much like a woman standing in front of a salad, asking it to be the biggest piece of cheesecake that probably Atlantis can give you, covered in caramel and strawberries, I am standing in front of you asking for your vote and for your support. My name is Judi Rought, and I am running for Reno's future. Thank you.
Hi again. I'm Tabitha, and I always knew I would run for office at some point in time in my life. And the reason I'm running now is because moving back to Reno in 2019 and opening my business, right after we opened our business, COVID hit. And we had zero communication after the city shut down and zero leadership. I don't know how many people in this audience and online feel that we need new leadership, but we do. And I hope that you'll consider me to be that leader. I feel that my experience in real estate development will allow me to continue to work with the developers and again city council to really truly bring affordable housing to this community. Not talk about it for another 10 years. I look at the debates from 2018, we're still talking about the things they said they were gonna do in 2018. And I bet if I watched the debates from 2012, they were still talking about what they were gonna do. I wanna do it. I don't want to be another politician up here. And in 4 years, we're still talking about what we think we're gonna do. We've been living in really divisive times, especially the last four to six years. I wanna bring Reno together. We might not always see eye to eye at the end of the day, but I promise I'll always vote in the best interest of this community. And I'll always be approachable, and I'll listen to what you guys feel are the issues and also the solutions. So with that said, I guess I'll be the last person to speak and hand this back over to Connie Ray. Thank you guys for coming tonight. I hope you'll consider me for your next mayor. And again, follow me on Facebook and my website, Tabitha for Mayor. Thank you, guys.
Can we get a big round of applause for all of our candidates? Thank you all for being here today. I also want to give one more thank you to This Is Reno before I hand it off to Bob. And I please encourage you to support local media and subscribe to This Is Reno. It's an online news platform. They work so very hard and we so support them. And thank you again. We hope that you will join us out here next Thursday. Again, next Thursday, May 12th is the Washoe County Commission Forum. And the following Thursday, May 19th is our Reno City Council Forum. With that being said, thank you all. I'm going to hand this back over to Bob. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you all. I don't really have much to add other than to say thank you so much. What an incredible group of candidates we have here tonight. Thank you so much. Good luck in your campaigns. Thank you all for showing up. I do apologize. We don't really have time for questions, but it's great to see you, and hopefully you'll be back next week. Thank you.